Okay. Well, good morning, everyone. So as said, I will now focus on impairments. Just as a starting point, this slide reminds you of the history of the project and the main timeline. So as you can see, I won't detail the history of the project, but you can see that it's been going on for several years now. So I've been following the most particularly the impairment project over the past 5 years. So I could spend the day discussing about it, but I will try to make it in 20 minutes. As you can see on this slide, we are expecting a final standard very soon, so probably in July, hopefully. And so we now know that the mandatory application date for this new IFRS 9 standard will be 2018. Which gives the banks more time to prepare. So I will now, as you can see on the impairment phase, we have had several proposals before arriving where we are today. And it's been quite challenging for the IASB to define a new impairment model, knowing that the main target was to design a model which would be more reflective of expected losses ahead of the trigger events that we need today to book impairment allowances for credit risk. And what has been challenging was also that they were trying to design a model that would be converged with the FASB. So the idea originally was to have one single model for both the US and the IFRS world, which in the end failed, but it also explained why it took so long to design a new model. So I will now directly jump to the slides which relates to the impairment model. First, one important point to have in mind that the new impairment model that I will now describe will apply to all debt instruments, so not only loans booked at amortized cost, but also debt securities, which will measured at fair value through OCI, as was just explained, since in the end we maintain this category, so the equivalent of the available for sale category that you know today. The new impairment model will also cover trade receivables, lease receivables, but also off-balance sheet commitments such as financial guarantees and loan commitments. So currently today, under the current model, we have different models for all these commitments, but now we will have only one single model. So typically for available for sale debt securities, as you know today, we have the same trigger events to identify an impairment, but once we conclude that there is an impairment, we just recycle the entire negative OCI reserve in P&L. Tomorrow, we will have to calculate impairment allowance the same way as we do for amortized cost loans. So that's the new model. So we already touched on it briefly. What is important to understand this new model is that one of the main targets was to get rid of the trigger events as necessary starting point for booking an impairment. The idea was to say, well, banks are well aware that all their portfolios bear expected losses. They know that these expected losses will occur in the future because they have historical statistical data that allow them to know approximately what these expected losses will be, and we should be able to reflect that more earlier in the measurement of loans. So as we know under the IAS 39 model, you first book interest income when the loan is performing, and it's only when you identify a trigger event that you will suddenly recognize the expected losses on these loans. So that you have you could consider that this model is quite unbalanced because you start by recognizing interest income, not taking into consideration the expected losses, although you know that they will occur one day. And then when the trigger events arises, then you have the impairment loss. So the idea was to say, well, we should take into account the expected losses earlier in the process. So the original idea, and I would say the ideal model for the IASB, was to incorporate directly the expected losses in the calculation of the effective interest rate. And if you could do that, you would have a revenue recognition on the loan, which would directly embed the expected losses, so that you would not recognize too much interest income, and you would provide for expected losses gradually over time, and would have enough impairment allowance when the credit event would occur. So that's the ideal model that they originally designed, but it was obviously very complex to incorporate directly expected losses in the revenue recognition, because implementing effective interest rate is already complex. So if you try to add to that expected losses, then it becomes very difficult. So all the banks said, no, we can't have a combined model where we combine interest recognition and impairment. We need two separate measurement models. So the model evolved, and where we are today is a kind of compromise between this ideal that the IASB originally contemplated and what can be operationally implemented by banks. So where we are today is that we have these three stages. So we used to call them three buckets. So I may use this term again because I'm very used to it. So you have the first bucket, the first stage, where all loans should first initially belong. So there are a few exceptions, but I will focus on the most general cases. So any loan should have an impairment allowance that reflects the 12 months expected losses. So it's not the entire expected losses that you expect for this loan, it's only the expected loss that you expect over the next 12 months, which is a data that banks are quite well used to because they use it for regulatory purposes. So why 12 months? Well, clearly it's a compromise. It's also a way to say, well, we should have ideally expected losses embedded in the EIR, in the effective interest rate. We can't do that, so we'll provide for 12 months, and it's a way to approximate what we would have if we could embed the expected losses in the interest revenue recognition. So all loans should have a 12 months expected loss impairment allowance booked for them, which is a significant change as compared to what we do under IAS 39, where all performing loans has just zero impairment allowance provided for. Then the IASB was keen to keep a model which reflects the deterioration in credit quality. So what you have here is that once you observe that the credit risk has increased significantly since initial recognition, you should then extend the horizon of expected losses that you provide in your impairment allowance. So you will transfer your loan from what we call bucket one or stage one into bucket two or stage two, where the impairment allowance is extended to the entire lifetime expected losses. And then we have this third stage or third bucket, which in fact reflects what we would currently call incurred loss under the current IAS 39 model. So it's a stage where you have observed objective evidence of impairment at the level of the individual exposure. So it's clearly an equivalent of a default. So stage three is meant to reflect approximately what we would have under the current individually incurred loss model today. And the important aspect of this model is to have in mind that the idea of the second bucket, so stage two, is obviously to reflect lifetime expected losses earlier than what we would do today. So the challenge clearly for banks when implementing this new model is to find ways to identify and capture what we would call the significant deterioration, because obviously it's meant to be identified ahead of default, which raises quite challenging questions for banks which mostly rely on delinquencies to identify deterioration, because in the under this new model, the idea is to identify a deterioration ahead of delinquency. So we will see what is proposed here, but that's an important point to have in mind. And as you can see, with respect to the interest revenue, the ISB has agreed to decouple interest revenue on one hand and impairment allowance on the other hand. And the only stage where both are recombined, as we would do today, is when you are in stage three, so the equivalent of our incurred loss today, where you will only book interest revenue on the net carrying amount of the loan, which means the gross amount minus the impairment allowance. But under stage one and stage two, you just recognize your interest revenue as if there was no impairment allowance. It's two completely separate processes. And in terms of impacts, what is quite obvious is that under IAS 39, you already provide for the lifetime expected losses when you have an objective evidence of impairment. So for the third stage, you should not have an impact. The impacts are obviously expected on stage one and stage two. But then the magnitude of the impact is very much dependent on how you apply currently IAS 39 for collective provisioning, because collective provisioning will give you an impairment allowance for the equivalent of bucket one and two. So it all depends on how you apply the current collective provisioning model. And we can see that the practices are quite varied. We have certain practices in France. There are other practices in other countries. It's very varied, and it's also a key challenge for regulators, which is to ensure that this new model will be applied in a consistent manner, because you can well see that there is a room for judgment everywhere in this new model. There is room for judgment about when you should transfer into stage two. There is room for judgment about how you will calculate your lifetime expected losses, and we will see that you can obviously rely on Basel II data, but you will need to adjust these data because they are not completely consistent with what the accounting model requires. So obviously, on all exposures for which you currently have no impairment allowance at all, you have a mechanical impact, which is to book the 12 months expected losses. And then for all the exposures which are currently collectively impaired, then it will all depend on how you define collective impairment currently. And as I said, there are different methods. Well, this slide illustrates the importance of the transfer criteria that will be defined for going from stage one to stage two, because there are two combined effects when you operate such transfers, which is first that if your loan has deteriorated, the 12-month EL has already increased without mentioning any transfer. So the EL mechanically increases because the loan has deteriorated, but then, in addition to that, you extend the horizon of expected losses that you provide for in the impairment allowance. So you have the combination of two effects, which explains why we call that the cliff effect, which makes it very key to define the deterioration criteria and to be able to anticipate how this will affect your impairment allowance, because all the banks need to know approximately how their impairment model will react to a deterioration in the environment. Just one point about expected losses. The ISB did not want to develop new concepts which would have required banks to develop a parallel data in addition to Basel II data. So the idea that the bank should be able to rely on what they use for risk purposes. So they can rely on their Basel II models, they can rely on their risk data, etc. The idea is really to leverage on that. But the accounting model require the banks to use data which reflects current conditions and also what they call reasonable and supportable forecasts. So the idea is to have a certain dose of forward-looking anticipation in the estimate. And you can see that this does not completely match with what you do under Basel II models. So the banks will need to adjust what they do. Clearly, for Basel, the data are through the cycle. You have regulatory adjustments such as the fact that your loss given default should be downturned. So there are many small things in the design of the Basel II data, which will need some adjustments in order to be used in the accounting model. And clearly, the building the expected loss over the lifetime of the loan will be a main challenge for banks, because they generally have 12 months EL, but extending it to the lifetime for all exposures will be quite challenging. In terms of concept, as I said, the default typically is not defined, because the idea is to rely on what you already apply in terms of default definition. There is a rebuttable presumption that default does not occur later than 90 days past due, which is mainly consistent with Basel II definition, although there are some exceptions. And one important point is that what we call significant deterioration, so the indicator that will trigger the transfer in lifetime EL, is meant to rely on probability of default. And that's a very important point. It's not, you should not take into consideration the loss given default in the assessment of significant deterioration. It's all about whether the borrower will pay or not, and which means that you need to differentiate in the expected loss estimate what relates to probability of default and what relates to loss given default. I will skip the discount point, but you can refer to it in the slides, to go to the operational simplifications which have been put into the model. So clearly, the idea is to capture significant deterioration in risk with what we call a relative approach. It all depends on the credit quality at origination. So you are required to identify a deterioration as compared to the original credit quality, which in theory requires banks to keep to track all the credit quality at origination to be able to really identify a deterioration. It's not, as we have today, I would say, an absolute threshold where you know when something is impaired or not. Here, it all depends on the credit quality at origination, which creates a lot of complexity. So we have some simplifications in the model. The first one is relates to what is called low credit risk instruments. And here the idea is to say, well, we will consider that as long as we stay in a certain range of very good credit quality, we don't need to bother about assessing whether or not we have a significant deterioration. So that as long as you stay in this range, you have nothing to do except, of course, booking your 12 months EL as an impairment allowance, but you don't need to bother about measuring variation in credit quality. So that's what we call the low credit risk exception. It's clearly meant to represent what would be an investment grade quality if we compare it to agencies' notations. But you don't need to have an external rating. You can map your internal ratings to external ratings and approximate what would be an investment grade quality. But it's quite, as you can see, it's a very high credit quality, so clearly this operational simplification is of no use for most retail exposures, but it helps for debt securities. And then, so it's not investment grade, not investment grade is not meant to be an absolute threshold. If you go from investment grade to investment grade, it does not necessarily mean that you need to book a lifetime EL provision. It only means that then you need to assess whether or not you have a significant deterioration. And that's where the complexity arises, obviously. We don't have any quantitative trigger in the standard. The standard does not say, well, when your EL goes from 1% to 2%, then it's a significant deterioration. All the banks will have to define their own criteria, their own range to identify a significant deterioration. And most probably banks will try to, even though the model is meant to be relative, so you need to compare original quality to current quality, banks are trying to design easier threshold that could be used homogeneously for portfolios. So let's say that you know that you don't originate beyond a certain credit quality, maybe this could be used as a simple threshold to identify a significant deterioration. But this assumes that your quality in the portfolio is quite homogeneous originally. Otherwise, you can't use the same cut for all the exposures. Well, in theory, as you say, the model is meant to reflect current condition and supportable and reliable forecasts. But so the challenge will be to obviously the risk is that there is always a conservative bias in this forward-looking estimate. So it's quite evident that auditors and regulators will be more keen in anticipating a deterioration in the economic environment, but in theory it should be symmetrical. So if you have good evidence of things improving in the near future, you should be able to adjust downwards the PDs, or maybe not the PDs. Probably what will happen is that this forward-looking component of the estimate will probably be more an overlay on top of what your risk models will provide you. But it's meant to be symmetrical, so in theory, if you expect improvement, you should be able to reflect it in your estimates. But then we have the human conservative bias that will probably come into play. So, but in theory, it's meant to be symmetrical. And the idea, there has been a lot of debate during this project because there was a strong pressure from the regulators to have the ASB embed more conservatism and more, well, aspects that the regulators are very keen to see reflected in the model, but which are not necessarily compatible with what accounting is meant to reflect. Accounting is meant to reflect current conditions. It's meant to be a good compass to know where you are today. So if you incorporate directly into that, I would say, conservative regulatory aspect, then the compass is a bit broken. So the ISB was very keen to keep it pure, as much as we can expect it to be, and so it's meant to be symmetrical. There is a second simplification which relates more to retail exposures. Obviously, the low credit risk simplification that I just mentioned is useless for retail exposures because they are generally not investment grade at inception. And so here, the ASB has said, well, we know well that some entities are not sophisticated enough to have rating systems for all their portfolios mapped to PD and LGD, etc. So we need also to take into consideration entities which mainly rely on a delinquency to identify a deterioration. And here what has been put in the model is to say, well, there is a rebuttable presumption that when you reach a 30 days past due status, you have significantly deteriorated, which means that you should be in stage two and provide for lifetime expected losses. So that's a rebuttable presumption. Is if you have good statistical, historical data which demonstrate that a 30 days past due indicator is not really predictive of a default, you may rebut the presumption, but there is a presumption. And here, what has been added in the latest version of the project, because there were also a lot of debates with regulator, which considered that 30 days past due was not really was not an early trigger and would not result in improving the level of impairment allowance as compared to what we know today under IAS 39. So there has been a lot of debate about how can we add a layer to these delinquency measures to ensure that the model anticipates losses early enough, so that we have now in the project a stress on the fact that banks which rely on delinquency should really try and design additional ways to anticipate deterioration through portfolio approach and taking into consideration macroeconomic data. So it's easier said than done, but the idea is that you should try and find relevant correlations between certain macroeconomic data and your portfolio to do something earlier than just delinquency. So there are several. There will be several examples which will help design that. But clearly, what is at stake here is to be able to identify in a granular way how such or such macroeconomic data or specific indicators, such as unemployment rates or loan to values or interest rates, etc., can affect the level of risk in your portfolio. And the problem is that if you're not granular enough, you could end up transferring your entire portfolios in stage two just because you can't exactly say, well, if these indicators deteriorate, I know exactly what sub-portfolios will most significantly deteriorate. If you can't do that, then the consequence is that you can't be precise enough in the transfers, which can be very detrimental. So that's a key challenge here, finding the right approach to anticipate transfers early enough when you rely on delinquency. I think maybe a last word, there is a simplification for lease receivables, simplification which is can be considered quite punitive, in fact, because the idea is to say, well, for receivables and trade receivables and lease receivables, to simplify the models, we will allow banks or corporates to only book lifetime expected losses. So it's easier, but obviously your impairment allowance is immediately bigger because you provide for the entire lifetime expected loss at origination. The only advantage is that you don't have to track deterioration because you only use one single measure for the impairment allowance the entire life of the exposure. So maybe, well, you will see in your slide deck that there are many slides about the impacts. So just one word, when we say impact, it means financial impact. How will the impairment allowance increase when we will apply this new model? As I said, it depends on how you currently apply IAS 39. It will depend on the term structure of your loan portfolios. The longer they are, the bigger the EL, probably especially for stage two. It also depends on the credit quality of the portfolios. That's quite obvious. And it's very difficult to give a range of magnitude because it will, as I said, it will depend on all that. But generally, when based on simulations that have been made by bank, we generally consider that the range of increase in the total provision would probably be around between 20% and 50%, so it's quite significant. But again, a big caveat on this range because it depends on many things. And impact is not just financial, it's also operational. You will see in the slide that there are many operational challenges for banks to implement this new model. And the idea is really to leverage on what already exists, but it may be necessary to develop new risk models to have the expected loss data. So it requires a lot of work, which also explains why the mandatory application date has been postponed to 2018. And I have also put at the end some slides around where banks are in their implementation project. You can see that I have put two polling questions that we had raised at different dates. And so one saying that most banks would expect that it will take 3 years to implement this new impairment model. But then at a later date, when we asked where they were in their implementation projects, they were not so organized to really take the 3 years that were given to them, especially if you consider the fact that it would probably be very relevant to have a one-year parallel run before the standard is actually implemented. But the AQR doesn't help in the banks in preparing IFRS 9, so probably projects will really start in 2015 once the AQR is, I hope, behind us. But bear in mind that it's a lot of work, and that it's important that banks prepare themselves early enough to be well prepared.
Many thanks, Laura. I would encourage you to ask questions because you have two real experts here, and sooner or later you will have to deal with these problems, with the implementation of this standard. So if you have questions, even things that you are not sure you have understood correctly, whatever, I would encourage you to take opportunity of having Guido and Laure with us. So please.
Doesn't function. Yeah, function. Could you give me, please, loss given default definition, because that's crucial term for this. This quite obvious what is default, but what is loss given default? Thank you.
Well, loss given default is not defined precisely. In fact, it's really meant to reflect the losses that you have measured historically for certain portfolios starting from default. So you start from default, you observed what your losses were with a discount factor, which is an important point in the measurement of EL. You should include a discount factor in the measurement of losses both between default and recoverable amounts, but also going back to the reporting dates, because generally Basel II loss given defaults data will include some form of discount factor, but the discount factor used varies from one country to another. It may be different, so that's clearly an implementation challenge to ensure that the discount factor used in your loss given default data is compatible with the accounting model, and then you need to discount it back between default and reporting dates.
Yes, that's some aspect. There's one aspect. But there is going on, what's actually realized loss? What's actually realized loss? When it comes to be realized?
Well, that's not precisely defined in the standard, so it's meant to be done the same way a bank already does it for its Basel II data. So if you start from default, you then have to consider everything which was recovered afterwards until write-off. Then it's true that you have to limit the horizon, but it should be the same as the one used by banks. So typically you measured everything recovered until write-off, where you think it's completely hopeless to recover anything again.
Question to the consistency of data, what comes into this model, because firstly, this year loss, expected loss actually, is something as statistical measure, but in the end, it is based on discounted expected cash flows. That's the data don't have same nature. They are different in nature. What about this? It can create some problems, not?
You mean the difference in nature is due to the discount factor or due to?
No. When you account about new financial instrument, for example, you should assess the 12 months loss. Yes. That's statistical measure. Mm-hmm. And in stage three, you should use by each loan, for example,
yeah.
Discounted expected cash flows discounted from this model. These are two different things.
Yeah, yeah. Well, exactly, in stage one and two, your EL will be based on statistical, historical data, because that's the only, you can't have an individual assessment of cash flows and discount individual cash flows. So it's true that between stage two and stage three, your assessment should change because it will shift from statistical to individual assessment. So, but then it also depends on the portfolio, because for very small loans, you would probably still rely on statistical estimates in stage three, as you can only do individual assessment for significant loans or corporate loans, where you can try and estimate individually what your recoverable cash flows could be. But it's true that in stage three, you will have to shift the estimate to, from statistical to individual for certain big loans.
And by stage three, we should assess future cash flows from loan, and we imagine we that there is 5-year loan, which has quarterly payments. There are 60 different payments. It is impossible to assess them each and discount. That's impractical. What in this case?
I'm going to give the micro to Laure again, but I would hear some other questions because I see some faces here. So if you have questions after the Laure answer, please do so.
In fact, there is no specific detail in the standard about that, because it's an operational issue and banks will have to find the best solution. The idea is that you can't, you are not required to be to have a level of detail incompatible with the estimate that you are able to do on a given loan. So there is the right balance to find between a reliable estimate and accuracy. I mean, it's all about estimates, so you can't pretend to be able to accurately predict timing, cash flows, etc. So the idea is to approximate the present value of recoverable cash flows at default date and then discount it back to the reporting date. But then, I mean, we will banks will do the best they can.
Any question? I think I have actually one. We can see that there's a lot of flexibility still in that model, and that the ISB wants to keep that judgment open as possible. But on the other side, we have the regulator, and the regulator doesn't like that flexibility because he doesn't. It's not that he doesn't like the flexibility, but he likes a comparability, and therefore, Guido, the question to you is whether you have thought about the further guidance yet at the Austrian level, and what are the discussion at EBA level about how to give a bit less flexibility in that model, or how to make the bank harmonize their thought about it?
Yeah, thank you about this question. Well, for the national level, we haven't yet had any discussions about more specific guidance on, for example, the significant deterioration criteria for the movement between stage one and stage two. What I do know is that there are ongoing discussions at the Basel level about the current credit valuation guidance, and to incorporate in this credit valuation guidance some aspects of IFRS non-related topics, expected loss topics, for example, and especially related to the significant deterioration criteria. So there will be some developments at the international level, and I think at the national level we will await, and at the EBA level, of course, too, and perhaps there will be some initiative in the future, but we will await these international developments.
Clearly, the implementation is a key issue, and regulators are very worried about how it will work. And there are discussions currently about setting up an implementation group at the level of the ISB with practitioners, preparers, auditors, regulators probably, to With no, the idea is not to publish a guidance, it's just to at least have a forum of discussions to ensure that people have a consistent approaches for that. So, but clearly, consistent implementation is the big challenge.
Mr. Ivanov from Raiffeisen.
Yes. Hello. My question would be actually stepping on the keyword which Pascal mentioned about the flexibility that the regulators do not like that much, and it is focused mainly on the recently published ITS standard from EBA on the forbearance. What should the banks expect in terms of evolution of these standards, and particularly should we expect a convergence between the default definition as imposed by the Basel II standards and the non-performing or non-performing exposure definition which EBA introduces? Because I know in the, and we know that in the ITS standard, in the preamble, it says that it's purely a reporting standard. It wouldn't mess that much with the Basel II definition, but eventually it would create a parallel universes. So should we expect some convergence in this respect?
I can respond to that one. As you mentioned, the reporting standards of the ITS on forbearance measures is related to report on to regulatory reporting issues only first. Of course, it may affect other fields. It may affect accounting, as the forbearance definition might be used for accounting accounting issues. For example, it might be used as IAS 39 impairment triggers until IFRS 9 will come into effect. So there might be effect, and I think it's quite probable that banks will try to harmonize the definitions and might use the forbearance definition of the EBA for accounting purposes too, as far as it's provided for in the accounting frameworks and it's in line with the accounting frameworks. So that's my impression.
I was going to say that I don't think it's viable for banks to have different sets of your default non-performing forbearance restructuring. I mean, it's a nightmare. So, and the AQR process really embodies this nightmare. So I expect that everything will converge. I don't know who will converge towards whom, but in practice, banks can't cope with different definitions. So typically, with respect to non-performing, typically in France, one of the main differences relates to the number of days past due, which is tolerated to consider before you have a default. And I have already heard that some banks are considering just adjusting it to the 90 days to avoid. So I'm quite sure that, but typically forbearance is very challenging to implement, so it first requires some time to just collect the data to have the status.
Hello, I come from Croatia, Croatian Banking Supervision. I would like to ask you, once you mentioned during the presentation that the expected losses used for regulatory purposes could be used in the IFRS 9 model, which I don't understand, because regulatory expected losses are changed only once a year, once you challenge the model and you do the backtesting. Whereas I assume that even if you do annual reporting, and most of the banks do at least semi-annual sort of financial reporting, you should assess expected losses in 12 months period after this reporting date. So generally, this cannot be used. So I'm stuck for the last few years understanding, as a colleague was asking, what sort of types, what sort of calculations banks have to support in order to get to these default values or expected loss values based on those two models, because they do not match, according to me. I was not assure that they, these are the numbers that can be used for both purposes, because they have completely different origin, although they are named the same, I think.
When I say that they can be used, the idea that it could be, it should be the starting point and the first building block of for building 12 months a year, you're right, there is a question about the frequency of the recalibration that is made, but then again, this is not at all addressed in the project. The idea is to assess it the best you can, but typically recalibration cannot be done every 3 months either. So you have to find a way to maybe the recalibration can be done more frequently, but it's, I understand that it's a very complex process and you need time to just have enough data to recalibrate the model. So then maybe it's more a question of adding the what I call the additional overlay, which is often mentioned by the ISB, it's to say, well, maybe you would start with your Basel II EL and then take into account more recent data. It will not be a full recalibration, as risk experts would call it, but it will be an additional layer that you add on top of your Basel II EL to take into account recent developments, so maybe a recent default data or just economic macroeconomic data. It's true that you will have to add something to that to take into account that it was only recalibrated 1 year ago. You're right, it's not sufficient, but then your statistical approaches can only be adjusted, you know, and it requires some time, it's very complex. So the ISB knows very well that EL models are not recalibrated every 3 months, that's clear, but you should then supplement it with something which would be more a judgment overlay, taking into account recent events.